You are listening to Feminist Current. I'm Meghan Murphy. In 1979, Janice Raymond published The Transsexual Empire, which was, as I understand it, the first and probably still most well-known book articulating a radical feminist analysis of transgenderism. Little did we know then, 40 years later, trans activism would become possibly the biggest threat to feminism in decades. She warned us all early on, and now we are living it, watching women's sex-based rights be eroded in order to accommodate gender identity legislation. I spoke with Janice recently about the book, the backlash, what the women's movement is facing today, and what we can do to push back. Here's that interview.
It's interesting. I have a copy of The Transsexual Empire. It's really hard to find, as you probably know.
Well, it's on my website.
Right.
And it's free.
But, right, that's excellent news. But yeah, like hard copies of the actual physical book, I had a hard time finding a copy in any case.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I think I eventually found one through a used bookstore through Amazon. But it was interesting because there's a, I've had it for a little while now, but there's an inscription in it and it says, "For Joan, with much admiration for your courage, in the hope that you will find your wild self in haghood Jan."
Oh, yeah.
Do you know who that is?
I do not know who the Joan is. Maybe it was I was doing a book signing or something there. And,
okay.
I think it must have been some friend of Mary Daly's, because that's the, you know, Mary used that term a lot.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it's...
In haghood.
I like that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a name on the book. I guess the owner of the book must have written it in here. Joan Owls? Is it A-O-L-L-S or A-O-L-F-S or something? Anyway, someone in Massachusetts.
Mm.
But anyway, I thought that was nice.
Yeah.
So, and the other thing that I think is nice is that this book was published in 1979, which is the year that I was born.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, it's so...
that's sobering.
It is. I mean, one of the most interesting things about the Transsexual Empire is that so much of it is still relevant today. And it's sort of amazing to me that you wrote it so many decades ago and that we're still really having a lot of the same conversations. I guess, I mean, what first led you to write this book? What led you to write a book on transgenderism in the first place back in 79?
Well, initially it was my PhD dissertation, but at that time, this was, well, I was in graduate school during the early 70s, and that's when the feminist women's health movement was evolving. And I was in that movement, and in the process, we were challenging a lot of medical practices that negatively impacted women, you know, such as unnecessary hysterectomies, cesareans, and the like. And much of my teaching and writing and activism at the time focused on the use of technologies that were really destructive to women's bodies and their minds, things like lobotomies, which I did a lot of work on at the time. And I guess my early work in activism led me to question the medical consequences of what I see then and what I still see as the bodily mutilation that is inherent in transsexual surgery, and also the detrimental effects of taking, you know, lifelong hormones. But aside from that, the medical consequences, I really wanted to show that cutting off a healthy penis or breasts, being pumped full of hormones, often embarking on secondary surgical journeys just to alter your appearance in a better way. All of that is a walking tribute to the power of patriarchal definitions of masculinity and femininity. And they essentially teach all of us that in a gender-defined society, it's easier to change your body than to change your society. So I guess, moving forward a little bit, I suspected that transsexualism, and later its more recent iteration of transgender, would change women's lives in a way that would attempt to define us out of existence. But I never could have predicted that transgender activists would have the cheek to rename us as cis women, TERFs, front holes, uterus owners, egg producers, chest feeders, and even non-men. So that was the start of it. And then I did a lot of other things in my writing during the 1980s. I was particularly writing on new reproductive technologies. But I also began to notice that trans activists began to challenge the feminist position on transsexualism, which there was somewhat at the time. There was certainly much more of a cohesive radical feminism at the time. And there was almost a kind of coming out about the fact, as they saw it, that transsexualism was a challenge to gender. And the language of transsexualism was, at that point, somewhat changing to transgender. And they began to claim that it was they who posed a radical challenge to gender, transgressing gender expectation, crossing boundaries of binary sex roles. And that was really the first inkling that there was a movement of transgendered people who were beginning to claim that they were the actual challenge to gender expectations. So then we move into the 1990s, and this self-declaration became very prominent, and there all of a sudden seemed to be loads of trans activists and who were really promoting self-declaration. So that all started really in the 1990s, and surgery and or hormones no longer became necessary to transitioning, although many trans self-identifiers do use hormones and still do. And, you know, in the earlier days, people would ask me, well, what's the big deal about transgender? Why is it such a significant issue? Especially in the, you know, the roster of pressing issues that concern feminists. But I think that as I saw it then and as I see it now, transsexualism and transgenderism raise questions of what gender is and how to challenge it. And while it may offer some sort of relief to a small part of the population suffering an acute case of this society's sexual madness, it certainly doesn't offer any comfort to those millions who find we are women in the right body, but the wrong society.
Mm-hmm. I wonder about the title of the book, The Transsexual Empire. What does that mean to you?
Well, that was meant to, I mean, a large part of the critique is centered on the coalition of medical specialties, medical doctors, psychiatrists, therapists, etc., who came together at that point to really make it some sort of a science with quotation marks. And that was also the beginning of the transgender industry, in the sense that the term empire, of course, was a takeoff on that. And the industry itself was really starting to be based in universities. There was the hospital-based gender identity centers that were treating adult transsexuals, what I called at that time sex role control centers. And these also began treating female and male children who deviated from traditional sex roles. And I wrote in the book, such gender identity centers are already being used for the treatment of designated child transsexuals. Well, I think that was a bit prophetic. It didn't take long before those centers would proliferate, and now there are at least 40 gender identity clinics that treat what's called children's gender dysphoria in the United States. So, you know, that brings us up to the phenomenon of what's happening really right now with a large number of children. Children who allegedly are seeking, or whose parents are now seeking, transsexual, transgender treatment. And that really, you know, people said, well, that's the old regime of transsexualism. But not really. The medical model still governs children's treatment. And it's no surprise that drugs like problematic puberty blockers, cross-sex hormones used after puberty to suppress it, it's no surprise that they've become acceptable. But there's been virtually no pushback from the medical community. So the term the transsexual empire was meant to really symbolize the industry, the transgender industry, which today is really out of control.
Right. And I mean, you write in the book that it's really about, you wrote that the medical model is at the heart of the transsexual empire. So I wonder, I mean, it seems clear based on what you just said, in some ways, how that is true. I mean, I guess I'm wondering if you can talk more about that.
Well, the whole philosophy of changing sex is based on the ability to change at least the appearance of changing sex. And so I think that's the issue that I was dealing with in the book. And I saw that, as opposed to, you know, the currents of transgenderism today, people who were considering transsexualism were considering surgery and hormones. There was no such thing as self-declaration. And so that really dominated, you know, the lives of people who were transsexualized at that point. And
there
were very, a kind of a set of regulations that you had to abide by if you wanted the surgery. And you had to conform to passing requirements. And all of that was part of that medical treatment, therapeutic treatment, and the requirement that you had to live in the sex of your choice for 2 years before anything, any medical procedure would be approved. So I think that that was my point, that it was highly medicalized, almost treated as a disease in the sense that it needed treatment. And so that was my point at that, you know, at that stage of the game. And a lot of people now are saying that, well, that isn't the dominant current of transgenderism. In other words, that most people at this point who want to transgender or who declare themselves the opposite sex, they're not going through these procedures anymore. Well, in the course of writing this book, I looked up some of the statistics for actually the numbers of people who were undergoing transsexual surgery. And it is enormous, absolutely enormous. And, you know, a lot of academics will say, well, today, it's really not medicalized. But certainly what is happening to children is as medicalized as it gets. When you consider that puberty is, you know, suppressed, and then if they stay in that course of treatment, then they're subjected to cross-sex hormones at a rather tender age.
Things started changing. You know, nowadays, you know, of course, one of the big reasons that so many women started to push back harder against gender identity ideology is because they started changing legislation and policy and, you know, the activism and ideology itself, the politics around transgenderism, to say that it's just about self-identification. So it doesn't matter if you have surgery, if you take hormones, if you, so, you know, live as the opposite sex, in quotations, whatever that means, you should just be able to declare yourself the opposite sex, and it should be accepted, not only by those around you, but legally it should be accepted. And moreover, you know, it's become, you're not even allowed to say that it's a medical condition, or that it's like a mental condition or a mental illness, you know, which is odd, because I don't know how else you would define what they call gender dysphoria. But I mean, when did you see all that changing?
Well, you know, I wrote in the book, this was not part of my doctoral dissertation. It was a chapter I added after I got the PhD. It was a chapter, I think I called it Sappho by Surgery. And I saw that kind of thing happening quite early, with men who began to claim they were trans lesbians. My partner started Bread and Roses restaurant in Cambridge at the time. And she would come in, she would come home and say, my God, you know, this guy came in with two women under each of his arms, and he wants to play on the women's softball team, and he just blasts the ball, you know, right out of the pen. And all of that was beginning to happen. And that was, of course, what I call self-declaration. You didn't have to have any medical treatment to become what was called by them a trans lesbian. And there was more and more demand for access to women's spaces, women's restaurants, which were prevalent at the time. Women's, you know, even in the locker rooms of universities, my female students would tell me that this guy came in and claimed he was a woman and said he wanted to use the women's locker room. The bathroom issue, yes, earlier. And so the trans lesbian thing is not, it's not new, it's old. It's just that there weren't many of them around. And, you know, now, of course, men who identify as trans lesbians go so far as to deem it discriminatory if lesbian women reject their sexual advances. And this whole, I kid you not, of the renaming of the penis as a lady stick. I mean, I think that was incipient at the time. And today it's the norm. I mean, what I never would have predicted was that, well, it wasn't any internet at that point, but that they did not have a platform like the internet to violently, you know, mock any gender critic. I got a lot of email once we started to use email, and that was the favored venue on the internet. But it was really happening gradually. And I think that the number of transgender activists who are in the online industries are managing a lot of things, like, for example, your exile from Twitter. I think that a lot of transgender activism has begun on the internet and is now also out of control.
Why do you think there was that switch? You know, why did things move from this purely medical model to this self-ID model, and the idea that you should just be able to declare yourself the opposite sex? Like, that's so normalized and mainstreamed.
Well, it's a very audacious claim, you know, yeah, to say that. And I think that it's very interesting that, and this is why I also want to speak a little bit before we terminate the session about so-called trans men. I mean, I think that this has come from trans declared women. And it's one more way of, I think, taking over women's space. When you declare yourself to be a woman, of course, it smooths your way into women's spaces. And I think that, you know, all of that may not be in a guy's head, but it certainly is part of the whole movement that we're now seeing. I think that you know, the fact that this could even be put out there and some very rational people could jump on that bandwagon and confirm it is what is more shocking. And this is being, of course, institutionalized in universities. It's becoming, you know, I'm glad that I'm not teaching in a university at this point. I don't think I could last, given what I hear from some colleagues about what is happening now. I mean, with the kind of mobbing almost in classrooms, if someone makes a point that is not woke. So I think that it's rather clear that this is a very male-identified movement. And unfortunately, many women are glomming onto it.
Yeah, that's the thing that's baffled me quite a bit about this trend, and the way it has manifested itself and taken hold these days. You know, I guess it makes sense in some ways why men who identify as trans would want to be accepted, let's say, as women, or access women's spaces, maybe. I don't even know that, to be honest. I really completely understand the push to access women's spaces. I mean, why would a male want access to women's spaces? I suppose some might say that it was to avoid male violence in certain spaces, or harassment from other men, because they're, you know, they don't look properly masculine. But why do you think that... I mean, some people will say, you know, when I'm talking about these issues, and some people, and I'll talk about the way that, you know, politicians have gotten really on board, like left-wing parties have gotten really on board. Mm-hmm. They won't even listen to us, you know, the left-wing parties here in Canada, in Vancouver, where I live, the provincial parties. They won't acknowledge what our concerns are, they won't have conversations with us, they won't engage with us, and they're just so offensively rude about what women are saying.
Exactly.
They're calling us TERFs and transphobic,
right,
and bigots and all these horrible things. But it's not men, it's not only men who are doing it, it's lots and lots of women.
Sure.
It's lots of female politicians, women who would consider themselves to be feminist, mm-hmm, and advocates, mm-hmm, for women. Why do you think that is?
Well, I think that many people, at least that I speak with, know that self-declared women are not identical to natal women. But they just won't say so publicly because they fear being labeled a TERF or a bigot, you know, or an oppressor. Lots of people have expressed this fear to me privately at various forums. I get emails all the time saying, you know, I admire your courage. But then they confess that they can't challenge this trans ideology openly because they have a lot to lose, and they fear being called transphobic. And they see just what you said, what's happening to others about, you know, what they're called, the names, etc. I think another strand of this is other people just want to be polite, and so they'll conform their language, you know, to calling self-declared men or women, men or women. So I think that, well, Bob Jensen writes in one of his conversations that he feels that, you know, the people he speaks to about this are at pains to not hurt the feelings of trans people. But, you know, Then he says, sensitivity to others is appropriate, but should it trump attempts to understand an issue? Is it even respectful of trans people who to not speak about these matters based on the belief that the people in the trans community somehow aren't emotionally equipped to discuss it? So I think that there's a very, I think there's a mob mentality. I think it depends upon which group of people you're talking to and with. I know that institutionally, as I said before, what is really happening is that it is taking over institutions. Women's studies programs are being redefined as women, gender, and sexuality. Things like that. Legislation is being passed. I mean, New York City has this is similar to what the legislation is in Canada, that if you intentionally mispronoun a trans person, that you could be fined up to $125,000, which is ridiculous. And I don't think it's been enforced. I'm not sure about Canada, but I don't think it's been enforced in New York City, but it's on the books, so to speak. And I think the optimism that I have about all of this is what is now coming out of the trans men movement. And I think, you know, we talk so much about the sins, so to speak, of trans women. And I think even that has had a chokehold almost on what we discuss. You know, we discuss the really what's happening for the most part to what trans men are doing to women's culture. But any, you know, the media, the mainstream media, when they discuss trans issues, it's always about trans men, trans women rather. And there's so little visibility in the media compared to what is given to trans women. It's almost as if, you know, the women as trans men are being left out of the narrative. And it's almost as if all trans-identified women and men experience the same things in exactly the same way, and they don't. And I think what's given me optimism is that the fact that there's a majority of young girls now going down the path to becoming trans-identified men is only one part of that story. The greatest number of detransitioners are young women who have rejected their current trans status. Many who I find have written very eloquently about it. And I think that the good news is that many girls who underwent trans treatments, in contrast to boys undergoing such treatments, are detransitioning and becoming critics of transgenderism. And I mean, what gives me hope is that increasing numbers of female detransitioners are coming out of the woodwork. And I'm not remembering a name here, but when Charlie from the UK, who mm-hmm. is a detransitioner, started out her project and program for detransitioners and announced it, 300 women applied, you know, 300 women called. So what, as I said, what gives me hope is that a large number of self-identified men are reporting that they shifted identity from female to male because of the misogyny they experienced as women. And these self-identified men have also come to grips with their own internalized misogyny that propelled them to transition, where becoming a self-identified man is more acceptable than being a lesbian. And, you know, I just want to, I'm sure you're familiar with some of these testimonies, Meghan, but I think a lot of people don't understand really what is happening here and what the testimonies of detransitioners are actually saying. And just let me read a couple here. Conforming as male meant hearing the word rape used as a synonym for domination, humiliation, or asserting authority, and not being able to say anything. Being a man meant bragging about getting pussy and listening to over-dramatized fantasy versions of my co-workers' sexual exploits. It meant laughing at the misogyny saturating my world and profiting from it. This was one I could not swallow, though I tried for 3 years via a deepening subconscious hatred of my own sex. A lot of testimonies are like this. So how did I get to where I am today? I was sexually molested from the age of 8 to the age of 10. I bought the lies. At one point, I believed the gender craze. I advocated for the trans community. I did the TV circuit. Another. Growing up in a female body wasn't easy for me. Friends told me I should lose weight. I couldn't leave the house without men whistling after me, and people talked to my breasts instead of talking to my face. And finally, I regret it all. There's a very strong narrative that if you don't transition, you're going to kill yourself. And I think what's happening, what's in reading into these accounts, you know, you get these patterns that emerge of past sexual abuse and harassment, eating disorders, discomfort, even hating their bodies, estrangement from what I call compulsory femininity that they grew up with. And a lot of them, as a lot of the, you know, the quote-unquote trans men had consumed a lot of trans pornography that features the ideal trans-identified men who sport their muscles and showcase, you know, their native bodies, their natal bodies. Mm. But, you know, this is a process. And it's not immediate, and it takes sometimes years. But I think that this is changing. And I think that part of the reason is that that women have seen more clearly what is really happening here when they identify as male. And lesbians have been certainly intimately marked by their journeys to and through the promised land of manhood. And there's also a lot of eloquent testimony about, you know, seeing life from both sides. So that gives me a lot of hope. And I think what Charlie Evans is doing is incredible. Mm. And I think we're going to see a lot of pushback on this. We're already seeing a lot of it because people like James Caspian and the woman from Brown University, Lisa Litmore, whose research was on the frequency of detransitioning, and all of a sudden, you know, they get chastised or actually exiled from their universities, and their research gets stopped. Mm-hmm. Because it's just, you know, they don't want the numbers to come out of how many are detransitioning.
And right, and even, I think Lisa Littman, her research was on rapid onset gender dysphoria, as it's called, which happens specifically to teen girls. And as you say, I mean, she was, you know, completely, she wasn't support, she was attacked by trans activists, the research was attacked by trans activists, and the university didn't support her at all.
Well, the university actually took down the press release that they had issued about her study. And the academic journal called Plus One, they gave lip service to really, you know, saying that her methodology in places was wrong. But the article still, as it almost originally was, stands, luckily. That's one victory. James Caspian wasn't so lucky. He had his research proposal revoked. And when he was proposing conducting research that focused on the reasons why former transitioners chose to reject their earlier choices and go into the process of detransitioning. But he is now suing Bath Spa University in the UK, and I don't know where that legal challenge is going, but he said that the university backed off because when they were attacked on social media, it was a potentially political piece of research which carried, as the university saw it, risk to them and was detrimental to their reputation. And this is hard, I think, for me also as an academic to really understand how a university could cave in to that kind of pressure, because certainly it hasn't caved in to other things. And it's just happening to too many academics.
Mm-hmm. I'm wondering, when you published this book, what was the response? I mean, today, if you publish something like this, you would be virtually slaughtered and attacked and harassed and vilified and smeared. I'm wondering what was the situation when you published this back in 79?
Well, it got a glowing review in the New York Times book review. So it started me off on a very positive journey. But that all began to change very quickly too. And again, this happened almost overnight. I'm looking for something here and trying to find something about the censorship. Yeah, the censorship developed gradually. And in the beginning, when I was a student, you know, and I didn't even see this as censorship then, I had applied for a grant to research and write the dissertation that would become the book. And a prestigious U.S. foundation contacted me to say that the grant had been awarded and that it needed only some pro forma administrative signatures. They even paid for my medical exam because they were going to part of the grant was that they were going to pay for my medical insurance. Well, several weeks later, I was told by a colleague who worked at the foundation that the grant had been sabotaged by doctors associated with one of the evolving gender identity centers where I conducted some interviews, because they complained that my research would threaten their work. So, needless to say, I didn't get the grant. Well, as the 1990s rolled around, a transsexual identifying as a woman contacted Teachers College Press. Now, Teachers College Press had reprinted the Transsexual Empire in 1994. And this trans woman deliberately omitted, he accused me of deliberately omitting the preface to the original edition of the book in the new reprint. Huh? The transsexual wrote that I was guilty of scholarly misconduct since the 1994 version wasn't a true copy of the original book. The publisher, Teachers College, responded, stating it was their decision to cut the original preface from the reprint edition for reasons of keeping the book to a specific page length. So, okay, I won that battle. But not to be dissuaded, the accuser next contacted my university, reiterating that I was guilty of scholarly misconduct and seeking a disciplinary hearing to determine this far-fetched offense of academic fraud. So I was called in by my academic dean, and I was told that the university would conduct an investigation. And I countered with the fact that the publisher had already undertaken an investigation, and it was they who claimed responsibility for the preface. And I also added that if they mandated this disciplinary hearing, that I would be compelled to seek legal assistance if the university proceeded with what was a redundant investigation of such a frivolous claim. Well, he subsequently and promptly reversed himself. So, yes, those were early actions of censorship. Right around the same period, I experienced my first massive protest by trans activists, which are, you know, par for the course today, but it was at a feminist bookstore in New York City. And the gauntlet of protesters were legion, and it all felt very threatening, especially as I entered and exited the store. And that, you know, that was the beginning of all of that for me. In terms of wherever I spoke, even out of the country, I was subjected to those kinds of protests. And then... I'll mention one more thing, because it's just recently happened. Mm-hmm. After 40-plus years of dissenting from transgender dogmas, I recently learned that the women's studies program at my university, which was the University of Massachusetts in Amherst, they had many years ago, after I left, renamed themselves as Women, Gender, and Sexuality Studies. And I had taught in the women's studies department of that university for 28 years. And a colleague called me up and said, "Have you seen the message on the website of the Women, Gender, and Sexuality Studies Department?" I said, "No." And she said, "Well, you better look at it." So I did. And it was essentially, the message was on the website itself. It was apologizing for what they called, quote, "the persistence of legacies of trans-exclusionary radical feminism, including its presence in the history of women's studies at the University of Massachusetts in Amherst." So obviously they didn't name me, and it felt like it was a kind of a delayed send-off, because it was quite shocking to see that right on the website. But it was pretty transparent. They didn't have to name me, since no one else in the department's history was remotely identified with that research and writing that I had done. So anyway, that was the beginning of the end.
When you started getting protests, like those, the ones that you just discussed, did other feminists support you?
Other radical feminists supported me, yes. And some feminists who, for example, this colleague that I mentioned, who I would not call a radical feminist. In fact, she had been critical of some of my work. She supported me. It was mostly radical feminists, and it was, I got a lot of letters, quite frankly, and then a lot of emails saying, "I have so much admiration for what you're writing and doing. But this is what I spoke about earlier, but, you know, I can't do what you're doing. So it's kind of a phantom support, I guess, when people write and tell you, you know, they support your position, they support what you're doing, but no, they themselves can't talk about it.
Yeah, I mean, that sounds similar to, that extends today. I get those kinds of messages sometimes also.
Oh, yeah.
I know, you know, back in 77, Gloria Steinem spoke out about transgenderism.
Yes.
Because there was this situation of James Humphrey Morris, who was a British officer who transitioned to become Jan Morris.
Right.
And then there was a that tennis player, Richard Raskind to Renee Richards. And she, I'm sure you're familiar with this already, but just for those listening, she wrote, "Feminists are right to feel uncomfortable about the need for and the uses of transsexualism. Even while we protect the right of an informed individual to make that decision and to be identified as he or she wishes, we have to make clear that this is not a long-term feminist goal. The point is to transform society so that a female can go out for basketball and a male doesn't have to be the strong one. Better to turn our anger outward towards changing the world than inward towards mutilating our bodies into conformity." And she, you know, I think a few years ago rescinded, you know, because, you know, trans activists discovered that she had been critical of gender identity ideology, transgenderism back in the day, and went after her, and, and she came out and took it back and apologized, essentially.
Yeah, I wonder... I think this is what happened. Any place she went, she would be to speak. I think she was asked about it. And I think an enormous amount of pressure was put on her to change her position. And it was certainly disappointing to a lot of us because, you know, Gloria, I think, is one of the heroines of the women's movement. And she has been a certainly, you know, a friend to the work that I've been engaged in with the Coalition Against Trafficking in Women for many, many years. And I think she's been very important to a lot of feminist causes. And I think she's been criticized for not being radical enough. But I think she lives out her feminism, and she has done it also at great cost to herself in many ways. So I was very disappointed when I saw that statement because she blurbed the Transsexual Empire. She endorsed it when it first came out. But then again, I mean, there are other, you know, feminists, prominent feminists who have done the same thing.
Why do you think, I mean, have you talked to any feminists who've done the same kind of thing and asked them why? Or, you know, why, or do you know why they would rescind in this way? I mean, I understand that people want to protect their work and they want to protect themselves and they don't want to constantly be derailed by this issue, but at the same time, you know, you would think that it would also be important to stand with other women. And when you make statements like that, it does kind of throw the rest of us under the bus. And, I mean, I feel personally, and I'm sure lots of other women also feel, you know, that I couldn't not say this because what we're saying is true. There's nothing wrong with what we're saying. And because it's so important.
Well, I think for one thing, a lot of people don't know this side of the transgender movement. The kind of things, for example, that are going on in, even with an enormous amount of violence against women. If reading, you know, reading the tweets, reading a lot of this, they're not privy to that because that's not their thing, so to say. And I think that, you know, this is why what you're doing, podcasts, is really important because I, for example, you know, people don't even know that self-declared men exist as one point. They don't even know the kind of violent kinds of messages that those of us get, and that many in the trans movement now are turning on one another. That's a whole other story. You know, what can I say about it? I don't have a crystal ball in terms of how people think, but I think they think, for example, the mainstream media has so prioritized trans women, and now particularly in the progressive press, you know, we're hearing a lot about trans women who are in prostitution or pornography, or who arrive in domestic violence centers, battered by other men. And I think that there's a kind of knee-jerk response to that women are now identifying them as women, unfortunately, which they are not. And they're almost grateful for any kind of joining of organizations or joining of individuals who say we're women. And you know, a lot of women think that's great, because it means that they support us, they're with us. And it doesn't mean that.
I wonder where you see all this going in the future. You know, I will sometimes feel optimistic about this because I think that a lot of people are seeing the truth of what's going on. I think of, you know, a lot of people for many, many years, I don't really think thought about this issue at all.
Right.
And then, you know, feminists started talking about it, and a lot of people probably weren't aware or just thought, oh, this doesn't affect me. This is some weird niche issue. Who cares? And people around the world are waking up due to, you know, issues like the men playing against women in sport, mm-hmm. Issues like men being transferred to female prisons, men having access to women's washrooms and transition houses, things like that. And, you know, the conversation has really just blown up. And so I do see a lot of people kind of coming around and speaking out. But at the same time, I mean, this ideology has been totally institutionalized. So as you said earlier, you know, it's in schools.
Right.
You know, they're teaching this in schools. The universities have been taken over. All of, you know, almost all of the women's organizations and NGOs and charities are placating trans activists and, you know, changing their language and their mandates and things like that, you know, governments, political parties, so on and so forth. Do you see things turning around?
Well, that's one reason why I, you know, emphasize my optimism about trans men, because I do see that turning around in that corner of the movement. And I think that that's really significant. And I'm not sure that a lot of people know about that. And that's why I emphasized earlier that really trans women, it's even hard to say that, get all of the media attention. At least in the United States. I think it's a bit different in the UK. I mean, I think the major media, thanks to Julie and Sarah Didham and others, is very, is much more, you know, liberal about that issue than US media. I mean, every week practically in the New York Times, there is a positive article about some aspect of transgender. So I think that the UK is, I mean, I think the UK is a lot better off than we are. And I'm also optimistic about the Gender Recognition Act, which doesn't seem to have any teeth at this moment. And, you know, I think that we need more of a movement here which makes itself visible, because, you know, you have to lobby for what you want. And they have the money. The mainstream organizations like the Human Rights Campaign, this alphabet soup of LGBTQ, they are receiving a lot of money from foundations. Jennifer Bilek has written about this, and also from corporations that are now donating money to transgender issues. And so, I mean, we don't have anything that is comparable to that. And we don't always need that, but I think we need that now. We need a lobbying strategy, and we need to really think more strategically about what we can do to affect legislation. I mean, my experience as the co-director of the Coalition Against Trafficking in Women, you know, prepared me for a lot of that. And I had to do a lot of that. But now someone else is going to have to do it. And so, you know, it's important to be in those forums, and we're not there. We are, you know, we have our podcasts, and we have our blogs, and we have, you know, a lot of very good instruments with which to go forward. But we're not where legislation is. And that's I think, where we need to be.
Yeah, I agree. I wonder, before we sign off here, if you can tell us about your new book that you're working on.
Yes. Well, it's coming along, and as I said, there will be a big chapter on trans men, particularly the detransitioning movement. I also want to address some of the questions, you know, that we've been talking about in the podcast, why there is such an institutional hold on all of this, and why these supposedly powerful institutions like universities are cowed by bad press. It's also, the book is also concerned with the sexual objectification within the trans movement, the sexual objectification of women mainly, but also of transgendered individuals. There's a whole pornography, a whole transgender pornography section on many pornography sites. Sheila Jeffries has written quite a bit about this, and I'd like to just look at it more carefully from the point of view of the Bruce Jenners of the world, who are now sexually strutting their stuff as women over many, many mainstream magazines. It's going to deal with a lot of issues that I've mentioned, and also particularly with the particular violence against women that radical feminists and gender critical people, and especially lesbians, are now having to deal with as it comes over Twitter, as it comes into, you know, gatherings of women. And I think the only violence against women that really is acknowledged is that of trans women who come to the battered women's shelters, to the domestic violence shelters, at least here in the United States. When I told someone, a colleague, that I was going to include a chapter on trans violence against women, they said, "Oh yeah, that's really, you really have to talk about that, because they're, you know, they're getting a lot of that." And what she meant was, you got it, trans women, not natal women. So that was a wake-up call that a lot needed to be done about publicizing that kind of violence against natal women and against lesbians and against anybody really who dissents from transgender orthodoxies.
Do you have any idea when the book will be published?
I hope it will be published by the end of... Well, let's say I hope it will be submitted by the middle of 2021. So I have not got a publisher yet, but that will be another challenge.
Well, good luck.
Thank you.
I'm really looking forward to reading it. Thanks so much for talking with me today about all this. I've wanted to have a conversation with you about all that's gone on for a long time.
Well, thank you, Meghan.
You just heard an interview with Janice Raymond. Janice is Professor Emerita of Women's Studies and Medical Ethics at the University of Massachusetts Amherst, and the author of 4 books. She was also co-executive director of the Coalition Against Trafficking in Women, CATW, from 1994 to 2007, then served on CATW's board of directors for many years after that. You can learn more about her work and access her writing at janiceraymond.com. That is all the time we have for today. I'm Meghan Murphy. Thanks for tuning in to Feminist Current. You can find us online at feministcurrent.com, tweet at us at feministcurrent, or send us an email at info@feministcurrent.com. We are hosted by Libsyn, and you can subscribe to the Feminist Current podcast anywhere you like to listen: iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, Pocket Cast, TuneIn, Spotify, and beyond. You can even give us 5 stars and a review on iTunes. Feminist Current is produced and hosted by myself, Meghan Murphy, out of Vancouver, BC. If you enjoyed this podcast, consider making a donation to support our work. Just visit feministcurrent.com and click the donate button.